and the woman is down. Mr. Bird with a wave of the hand. City's ablaze, the stars on fire. Woman's flame to reaching higher. We were fools, we called a liar. Is Bird.
I was asked to join in maybe April, May, and officially in the papers in June. Of course, by June, when I was announced, we were actually kind of looking for a singer. I'd moved in with Ian Paice. I'd become very friendly with Richie. We'd gone to the inaugural Hamburg incident where Richie likes to take new guys. Spent a weekend with Richie, and of course, John Law is a fabulous fella. And felt very much part of the organization. And, you know, auditioning a singer was not really difficult because there was only one guy we ever auditioned. It was David Coverdale.
I sent a tape and a photograph down and asked him if I could have the job. Basically, it was, I was working in a shop. And I didn't expect to get the job with Purple. If I'd gotten an audition, I was hoping, I knew they had their own record label, I was hoping that they could offer me something on my own or say, well, look, I'm afraid your voice isn't the sort of voice we're looking for, but we know somebody who is, you know. But after blowing with the band, I couldn't believe it, you know. I went apeshit, really. I couldn't sleep and all this bit. I'd always worked with good musicians, Steve, don't get me wrong, but this was like another level. It was so in tune with what I wanted, you know, and fortunately I was with what they wanted, you know. So it's worked out really very well. But it was the first time I'd gotten off my arse to do something, you know, and it played up.
Morning came, no one came, on the sinking was stood and stand. When it came, no one was spared.
Being a new guy in any band is always kind of interesting. David and I were 4, 5, 6, 7 years younger than the rest of the chaps. And I was coming off a career in trapeze, which we were knocking on the door very big in America. We'd already been selling 5, 10,000 seats a night, already had a top 60 record in America with trapeze. So I felt real strong. And it was a time for me where I was becoming a songwriter as well.
You know, we could not even try. You know we had no time.
The band had a great reputation, which it, you know, basically the new band had to live up to and go past if possible, you know. But it, like the moment I joined the band, it was never, you know, never mentioned by any member of the band that I was a replacement or Glenn was a replacement. As far as we were concerned, it was a new band, you know. The fact that it's called Deep Purple, because when you get the three musicians, John, Richie and Ian together, that is the nucleus and that is the sound of Purple. All I can do is write and put my voice on, you know, the things that I can. There's no way I can change the sound, you know, because Blackmore, John and Ian together have their own sound.
Normality than them. They've been living in this fantasy world
so many years.
Yeah, but presumably the contrast be...
I've always had the fantasy there, you know.
Sorry.
I've always wanted, I've known what it was about, you know. I just wanted to, instead of standing outside the door, I wanted to get in. You know?
And you're happy now you're there?
Very happy, yeah. Right.
People can there say to me, what's it like to be a superstar? And I say, pardon? Because I'm still really? Playing the same as I did before, but it's like changing a job. It's like anyone changing a job.
I'm playing change your firm.
I'm playing with better people. The money side is there. I mean, financially it's fine, but it's a change of job. And to be called a superstar just because you've changed your job or firm, as Ian put it, is just stupid to me.
I bought a foundation of groove. I bought more melody, as probably in the vocal department. I bought harmonic textures in the harmonies. And I added a little swagger, for sure, on the low end. With me, it's the notes I didn't play in Deep Purple that were more apparent than the notes that Roger played. It would have been silly to have a bass player come in and be a Roger Glover. And people have called me the funky influence in Deep Purple. They knew that going into it. That's my background. I am that kind of bass player. I'm a soul singer in a rock band. And I think the difference and the beauty of Gillan and Glover from Who Do You Think We Are to Burn stands up amazingly.
Well, it's a new direction altogether. And I think that I think they've got to forget the past and really do what they're going to do. I would like to see more strength of personality coming through. Mm-hmm. And I would like to see a little more naivety, a little less know-how.
Right.
But I still think the band's great. You know, if you want, you know, I'm really only picking up. I mean, it would be so easy to say, yeah, they're great, fantastic, and everything like that, which of course they are. But I mean, trying to be constructive, I would like to see a fresher, slightly more carefree approach instead of the cold, calculated approach, which I get a feeling is when I listen to music.
David Coverdale brought a very bluesy approach, which Ian Gillan doesn't have. A throatier, darker, deeper, soulful voice. And I don't use those words. I mean, I'm using the words soul and funky in a way I feel comfortable with. Let's use those words properly. Deep Purple were known as a hard rock band. Number one rock band in the world, if you will, at the time with Led Zeppelin and Yes. But like I said earlier in the interview, what's the point of having two clones of Gillan and Glover coming in and recreating Machine Head? A very bold move by the rest of the band to bring two guys in who are going to change the scope of rock again, and the Burn album stands up in the history and annals of rock history. You know, as far as Mark 1, Mark 2, Mark 3, I think Burn stands up with a classic album like Machine Head simply because it is a bold step forward. It is two new guys coming in with three very accomplished musicians who have stamped their authority on a record immediately. It was a very confident rehearsal period, a very confident pre-production. And I wasn't thinking about finances or touring. All I was concerned about was making my mark in a supergroup as a bass player and second lead singer.
You know, we had no time. We could not even try. You know, we had no time.
Unfortunately, the rehearsals, we were booked in for a month at this castle in Wales where Bad Company and Joe Cocker rehearsed and
right.
A few others. We just played football and had seances all the time. You know, that's all we ever did. And nobody ever bloody did anything, you know. It was terrible. We It's such a nice atmosphere, and it was like everybody was so lazy. Like John, he never used to get up till 6 at night, come straight down for a meal, stay there eating till about 10 o'clock at night. He'd go down to the studio and play, and by 10 o'clock at night I got pissed off anyway and I'd go to bed. So we hardly saw each other, you know. And then we suddenly realised we had about 4 days to left before we went to the studios. So we all went, oh, what are we going to play? What are we going to play?
We've never been great lyricists, and we don't write sort of fantastic melodies and tunes, you know, except for Child in Time, which is quite a pretty tune. I mean, there's not that many pretty tunes.
Is that something you regret?
No, not particularly. I regret it to the extent that if we could find a really great melody that would fit in with the way we play and the way we want to play, then fair enough.
You'd use it,
like a shot. But we're more of a... We don't construct our songs like, say, Rodgers and Hart used to, you know, or Lennon and McCartney, even. They're sort of amalgams of what everyone is able to...
A certain basic idea.
Ian might come up with a sort of a drum rhythm. He came up with a drum pattern.
You fall no one, but
opening the track on side two of Burn came purely and simply initially from a drum rhythm that Ian thought up.
Whereby Might Just Take Your Life came from an organ chord sequence that John had. So you start with a basic, simple little idea, then you get five minds saying, I think this would fit with that, that's what we do.
You know,
maybe why they're not too melodic, they're not too lyrical.
We're a rock band. I don't like the term hard rock, I don't like the term heavy metal. You know, I'd like to think of ourselves as a rock and roll band. Burn, Machine Head, In Rock, seem to centre around a specific kind of theme. Not even a theme you can put into words, but they hang together. You know it's part of that album, and it feels part of that album. And you can play the album from A to Z
without thinking,
oh, that sticks out like a sore thumb.
We're not brilliant songwriters, you know. I write most of the stuff, but I think some of it stinks, you know. We only get away with it because we're so good musically, you know. In fact, I wish some people would come forward and write songs for us, because we need it.
Bring myself to listen to the next album, you know, in a way, because I felt choked, and, you know, something I'd been a part of, and there was somebody else singing, you know, to start with. I didn't even want to listen to it. It was very personal, you know, the whole band was personal. We've been through a lot together, you know.
Right.
And the players, like, I'd never, you know, I'd never had such experiences on stage with such players. I've never been, for example, literally moved to tears, you know, when right. I first worked with Richie on stage. Unbelievable.
See, I have my own dressing room because I like to tune up and I like my solitude before I go on stage. I tend not to get too involved in people because, to be quite honest, I find a lot of people are boring. I find myself boring most of the time. I don't like to be caught up. I always like to be the opposite. I always was at school. That's why I don't smoke. I used to find everybody at school smoking, you know. Oh, it's a big deal, man. Smoke, you know, rebellious image. Like, I thought, well, because of that, I won't smoke. And I never have, you know.
maybe if they hadn't smoked, I would have done, you know.
Yeah.
Mind you, I was probably doing other things which were just as bad, if not worse. I'm still very moody, shy, and very honest, which a lot of people can't take, you know.
Honest?
Yeah. And which is, the hardest thing in this business is to, is sincerity. Once you can fake that, you're laughing, you know.
When Richie's in a band, there's going to be tension and friction, and that's the way it's going to be. And as soon as comfortable things set in, people would move and the tension would shift and people would have to leave or be fired, you know. And Byrne was the typical example of five guys living together, enjoying the parody of playing these great songs live, at least for 6 months, you know, while it was new.
Up to the first show, I was really worried. But the hearing the crowd reaction was unbelievable. It was like a dream. It was magical. I was in Copenhagen, which was one of my favorite cities in the world. And the reaction was amazing. Oh, I'd only seen things like that and read about them. You know what I mean? On TV or something.
Yeah.
But like, we were dragged off the stage and all this. And I was a buzz, you know what I mean? It was just like feeling that. You just felt fucking great. You felt good, you know? It was a feeling that had you bubbling inside. It was really very nice. And I thought, oh, I'm gonna like this. Audience reaction is the best dope in the world. You know, a good audience reaction. I can come off feeling fucking 2 feet taller. It's a great experience.
Recording, you find that there's one engineer and a couple of T-boys around, and it doesn't really inspire you to turn out your best. Whereas when you're on stage, you're playing to the people and they inspire you, obviously, you know. I suppose it's an ego thing, really. You like to kind of basically show off, show them what you know, and you get really inspired, you get real exciting thing going with the crowd because they just turn you on.
We don't have many bad nights. In fact, since we've started, we've got on three fingers we've had maybe three bad nights. And when we do have a bad night, we don't fight. We just walk off and we don't speak to each other. And the next day, we go on stage, it's like that. We don't ever argue intensely. When we criticise each other, it's always polite criticism.
Yeah, you're never shit, man.
Blackmore is one of the best, you know, like, as far as I'm concerned, he's a total electric musician. Him and Beck are on the same level as far as I'm concerned. Well, I think Richie's higher because he's more consistent, you know,
right.
As much as I love Beck. But I've heard Richie play some of the finest blues, you know, that's made the hairs under my neck stand on end. And he can also go to the extreme.
We got Blackmore at the tail end of, you know, Machine Head era into the burn where he could make me cry. Nobody makes me cry, really. No guitar players, you know, only other singers, but there are good singers. But some nights Richie Blackmore was so incredibly brilliant, and then some nights he would be incredibly crap, as he knows, for some strange reason of his own doing. But one thing Blackmore is, he's we don't have characters like Blackmore anymore. We have people that like to think they can be. Blackmore is a mystique. Blackmore could still come back and rock again if he wanted to. And he might. Blackmore to me was a great leader of a band, although some things were the behavioral department and all of us were stupid. But he ran that band pretty much the way he wanted to run it, whether it was immature or not.
I like black people that can sing rock and roll.